How do you feel things are going?
We've got some good stuff going on here. There was a bit of problems over there, but I think we'll do well. Why do we use the PCR method in this experiment?
Well, first of all, if you just start out with the original amount of DNA by itself, there's not enough of it. So unwind it by heating it, and you send in primers that sort of tell you where to start and stop, where to make the copies. Once those primers are in place, you heat it up a little more, and you get an enzyme that essentially says, make a copy of this section here, and it'll happen on both of the open pieces of DNA. And you do this repeatedly, and every time you open it up, that process that I just described repeats itself. But now you have more to work with. You've doubled it, and so the numbers begin to build up quickly, so that by the time you've done 30 cycles of it, you've got maybe a billion copies.
Why is the DNA blue?
Because we colored it with something blue.
Why'd you do that?
So we can see it and observe it better. Otherwise, if it was just transparent, it would look like nothing was happening.
What I found out was about the PCR will copy the part of the DNA that we were looking at, which was the on chromosome 16, and it was the PV92 locus. So what we did was that we took those DNA samples, and samples 12 through 14, we saw their bands and found out they were homozygous positive and homozygous negative and homozygous negative. So Mimi, what was your genotype?
My genotype was homozygous positive.
Okay, why do you think this happened?
Well, she said that like a lot of Asians are positive, so, and I'm from China, so. Yeah.
My results were homozygous negative, which means that I did not inherit the allo gene, and therefore I cannot pass it on. My parents could have both been either homozygous negative or heterozygous.
So now we're going to need to know what we can do with this. So we're going to go interview Professor Kobilinsky at John Jay College.
Hi, everybody. Hi. Hi. Please pull up a chair. We can learn a lot from studying ALU. So it is essentially a sequence that can change its position within the genome. In a sense, jumping from one place to another. We can use this information to learn more about ancestry. We can use this information to tell us about populations. For example, we know that the presence of ALU and the gene frequencies depends upon what population we're studying. If we come to a crime scene where somebody has been injured or murdered, for example, and there's blood and there's a murder weapon, it's very important to link those items of evidence. Theoretically, you could use the information to either include or exclude a suspect. We work with repetitious DNA, highly polymorphic loci. Let's say at the locus D3, which is on chromosome number 3, you have a 9 on one chromosome and the 11 on the other. And you might be, I don't know, a 10 and a 14. So it's easy to differentiate the two of you by looking at that one locus. But what happens if you both have the same genotypes? Let's say you're both 9-11. So what we do is we look at more other loci. And so we end up with what we call a genetic profile across 13 or 15 loci, which is essentially, it's your fingerprint. It's your molecular DNA fingerprint. So we have a tremendous, powerful system here to differentiate people and to do human identification.